Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Put your hands together in a greater. We applaud our children. Hosanna. Wonderful Jesus. Hosanna. Amen. Let the children give praise to the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We're so glad to be in God's house this morning. I want to welcome those who are here with us in the sanctuary and those that are listening online. We welcome you to Macedonia Church this morning on behalf of Pastor Brandon and the family of Macedonia. We welcome you. Macedonia, give a hearty praise and thanksgiving. Amen. Bless his wonderful name. Amen. And today as we celebrate Palm Sunday, I want to read a little bit about Palm Sunday. What is Palm Sunday? Palm Sunday is the day we celebrate the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, 1 week before his resurrection. As Jesus entered the holy city, he neared the culmination of a long journey toward Golgotha. He had come to save the lost, and now was the time. This was the place to secure that salvation. Palm Sunday marked the start of what is often called Passion Week, the final 7 days of Jesus' earthly ministry. Palm Sunday was the beginning of the end of Jesus' work on earth. Some 450 to 500 years prior to Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem, the prophet Zechariah had prophesied the event we now call Palm Sunday. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious. Lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. In Zechariah 9 and 9, he said the prophecy was fulfilled in every particular. And it was indeed a time of rejoicing at Jerusalem, well as Jerusalem welcomed their king. Unfortunately, the celebration was not to last. The crowd looked for a Messiah who would rescue them politically and free them nationally. But Jesus had come to save them spiritually. First things first, and mankind's primary need is spiritual, not political. Let me say it again. Mankind's primary need is not political, but spiritual. And mankind's primary need is not cultural or national salvation, but a spiritual salvation. Amen. So that is all about Palm Sunday. We're going to say a prayer. Let's all stand as we open up with our prayer this morning. We have an awesome time. The presence of God came as the leaders gathered for prayer. Amen. It was awesome. It's like God lifted us up in a realm of his presence, and I'm sure the same anointing. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. The same anointing is here, and we're going to be shouting all day, Hosanna, save us now. Amen. We need to be saved from all kind of hang-ups. And Jesus Christ come to seek and to save that which was lost. Bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came not as a conquering king, but as a humble servant on this Palm Sunday. We celebrate his victory over sin and death, paving the way for our salvation. Help us to live in gratitude for his sacrifice, reflecting his love and grace in all that we do. Oh God, as we enter Holy Week, renew our minds and spirit. Let the story of Jesus entering into Jerusalem inspire us to welcome him into our hearts afresh. May the palm we have symbolize our commitment to follow him more closely, to live lives of service and compassion, just as he taught us. Guide us through this week to the joy of Easter morning. We pray for the service today. We pray for unction. As the man of God gets up to preach a word, we ask you to let the anointing and the Spirit of God rest upon him. We pray that you may open his mouth to declare your word, Father, to speak that which you put in his heart. Let it come forth with liberty Let it come forth with freedom. We pray for the unity of the Spirit, that we may bring our minds in and that we may forget about everything and that we may worship Christ the Lord. That we may cry out to you, Hosanna, save us now from the evil and from the wickedness in our hearts and in our lives and that are around us. Hosanna, save us now. Oh, we want to be saved right now. We want to be delivered right now. And you are the Savior. You are the Deliverer. Our hearts cried out, Hosanna, Hosanna, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hosanna, save and deliver our nation. Save our neighbors. Save our children. Save us now. Save us now. Oh, we're in a time in our nation where it is politically upheaval. But Lord, we realize, God, we're not looking for a political salvation. Oh, but salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. When men's hearts are changed, our nation will be changed. When men's hearts are changed, we'll love one another. When men's hearts are changed, it won't be a Democrat or a Republican, but it will be one nation under God. Oh, bless your name. Bring us back to that place where we all bow at the cross of Christ. Bring us back to that place that we will love our neighbor. We may have difference of opinion, but we are one nation under God. In God we trust. Have your way this morning in our community. Oh God, close the door to evil and to wickedness. Close the door to all the plans of the enemy and send a revival. Oh, we decree this morning that Jesus Christ is the Lord of Norwalk. Jesus is Lord over this nation. We decree and we declare it. Hallelujah. Oh, bless Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Ah, he's a wonderful God. We honor you this morning. Have your mighty way. Let the blood that was shed, let it prevail this morning. Clear the atmosphere. Let there be liberty and let there be freedom. And God, we pray that somebody will be saved. That somebody will say, I need Jesus. I want to be saved. Oh, thank you for the way that you have made. Thank you for the plan of salvation. Save now. Hosanna. Save now. Save our children. Save our co-workers. Save now. Save now. Hosanna. Oh, to the King of Kings. Hallelujah. We thank you this morning. We give you all of the praise. Give you all of the glory. In the mighty, mighty, mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Give God a praise this morning. Thank you, Lord. He's good, isn't he? Hallelujah. Oh, yes. We're deliberate this morning. We are deliberate. We're going to make sure that our God gets the praise. Hallelujah. And all through the service, we're going to say, Hosanna. Hosanna. Oh, yes, to the King of Kings. We'll have the scripture reading this morning by Sister Annalisa Davis, Luke 19 to 28, 40, and from the King James Version. And after that, we'll follow with the voices of Macedonian praise and worship.
Good morning, saints. And when he had thus spoken, he went before, ascending up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass, when he was come nigh to Bethpage and Bethany, at the mount called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, Go ye into the village over against you, in which at your entering ye shall find a coat tied, whereon ye never man sat. Loose him and bring him hither. And if any man ask you, Why do you loose him? Thus shall ye say unto him, Because the Lord hath need of him. And they that were sent went their way, and found even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosing the colt, the owners thereof said unto them, Why do you loose thee this colt? And they said, The Lord hath need of him. And they brought him to Jesus, and they cast their garments upon the colt, and they set Jesus thereon. And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way. And when he was come nigh, even now at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. And he answereth and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Well, happy Palm Sunday, everyone. Happy Palm Sunday. Our babies just sung Hosanna, Hail to the King. Hosanna, Hail to the Great King. And what does he deserve? What is the highest praise?
Hallelujah.
What's the highest praise?
Hallelujah.
What's the highest praise?
Hallelujah.
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 Worthy Lamb that was slain. worship, Hosanna. We offer up a praise, Hosanna.
Everything we need is in the rock. Everything we need is in the rock that is higher than I. Thank you, Lord. And in the rock, there's life and life more abundantly. Life more abundantly. You don't have to die. Jesus. We're going to take this to church.
Joy, 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 joy,
joy. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Seems like somebody want to shout for joy today. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. A lot to rejoice for this morning. Amen. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you. We have joy this morning because of what this season, what it represents. It represents Jesus Christ. Amen. And we have joy. Hallelujah. Thank God for the joy, because the joy of the Lord is our strength. Hallelujah. Thank you. Amen. You have a whole lot of millionaires, but they don't have joy. Amen. Some are so famous, but they don't have joy. They're drinking, they're sleeping around, they're doing everything, but the joy that we have, my God, thank you, Lord, it's free. Bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the joy. Hallelujah. Bless your name. Thank you. And, you know, if you could bottle this joy and sell it, man, we'd be billionaires. Because people want joy. Amen. They're doing everything trying to find that joy. But I would recommend this morning that they try Jesus. Yeah, you want some of this joy that we have here today? Just try Jesus. You tried the bottle and it didn't work. You tried sleeping around, it didn't work. You tried making a few more millions, it didn't work. You try buying someone mansions, it didn't work. But try Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, bless his name, bless his name. Hallelujah. If you have to buy that joy this morning, some of us wouldn't have it, because it's not like we have a whole lot of money. You know? Some came out of the prison. Some were morally good. Not many making six figures. And if you have to pray for this joy, we'd be men most miserable. But I thank the Lord it was bought and paid for on the cross of Calvary. That's why I can say, Lord, thank you for the joy of the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank God this morning. Amen. We're just celebrating Jesus. We love him. You know, he has brought us a mighty long way. And every one of us, we owe our life to him. Amen. We owe our life. You know, I see sometimes people on, you know, they live their life all, you know, did everything they want to do on some of them, and they're dying bed and they still have no mind for the Lord. You know, I was telling my wife the other day, I know this individual, way up in age, they can't party no more. You know, they can't do all the things that the flesh want to do, but yet they want to accept the Lord. I'm saying, what are you waiting for? You have one foot in eternity. You know, just give the Lord your heart. You know, just turn it over to him. But one thing I like about the Lord, you know, he doesn't say, well, you didn't serve me all your life. You know, forget about you. But just like the thief on the cross, that last moment, God, I didn't live for you, but here I am in my shell and my worn-down body. Have mercy on me. And you know what he's going to say? Today you will be with me in paradise. That's the God that we're talking about. Oh, we love him this morning. Give God a hand clap. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. He's so worthy. Hallelujah. We've been seeking the Lord all week, and I believe the Lord wants to have his way today. Amen. Amen. We're going to give in our offering, and we pray now that you will stand and get ready to give back to the Lord as he has prospered us. Man, many don't have a job, you know. Many have no place to live. But God has blessed us so much. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Say, bring you all the tithe into the storehouse. Prove me now here with, say, the Lord, I will pour out a blessing. Amen. You will not have room enough to receive it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father, we just want to say thank you for this week and just what it represents. God, we thank you, we thank you, we thank you. God, as we think about what you've gone through to pay for our salvation, we owe our gratitude to you today. God, we owe it all to you. God, you've been so good. You've been so good. Even as we come to express our love for you this morning in our giving, we pray that you may bless the offering. Bless those that have to give and those that don't have to give. We thank you for having the faculties of our mind, for having reason, for having the ability to work, and for getting a paycheck every week. Lord, we thank you. We give back to you today, and we ask you to bless us with health, continue to provide for us, and most of all, provide for the needs of the ministry. God, great vision and great desire to do much for you, Lord, but we need the funds. So as we give to you, we ask you to open the windows of heaven and pour out on this ministry that which you put in your manservant's heart. All that you want to do, God, pour out that we can have a television ministry. Pour out that we can have a marriage ministry. Pour out that we can have ministry to the homeless or to the mothers that don't have anywhere to go. Pour out, Lord, that we can have a halfway house to hold those who came out of prison and have nowhere to go. Pour out a blessing, oh God, that we can go to the four corners of the earth to tell them that Jesus Christ is the answer. Pour out, Lord. Pour out a blessing. Open the windows of heaven. And all of your people today, those that are in need, that, oh God, that bills that need to be met, pour out, Lord. Make ways. Open the doors. Let there be raises, Lord. Give health to the bodies, that we won't have to spend money for medical care. Pour out a blessing today. Oh Lord, we receive it today. We receive it. We ask and we receive health. We receive a financial breakthrough. We receive all that the ministry need. Pour out, Lord, that we can burn this mortgage in this church. Pour out, we can finish downstairs. Pour out, we can get more properties. Oh Lord, thank you. Father, you pour out the blessings of the Lord in this place. Have your way today. Father, when it's done, we'll give you the praise for it. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. God bless you, saints.
you're still in celebration mode, correct? Correct? You're still celebrating the king, right? Come on.
Sometimes
Come on, if you know he's great. Come on, she said celebrate the king. She didn't say celebrate her. She didn't say celebrate me. She said celebrate the king. Let's celebrate the king. He's a great God. He's an awesome God. Listen, listen. We're here for a celebration, amen? I can't hear you. Amen. We're here for a celebration. So how could you sit there and they're talking about your great God? Oh, it's quiet in here. He's a mighty good God. Can we sing that again just for a minute? He's a great God, and can we unify it? Because he is a great God. I'm looking around the room. We sitting down, looking around, chewing gum, but he is a great God. And on this Palm Sunday, get your palms out and let's wave our palms to Jesus because he is a great God. Come on, let's go back into it.
He's a great God. He is my mighty Savior. He is my deliverer. Yeah. Great is the Lord. Hosanna to the highest. All hail to the King. He's a great God.
He's a great God.
He is my great God. Yeah.
He's a great God.
He is my way maker. Yeah.
He's a great God.
He's a great God.
He's a great God.
He is my deliverer. Yeah.
He's a great God.
He healed my mind.
He's a great God.
He healed my body.
He's a great God.
And told me to run on.
He's a great God.
He's a great God.
He's a great God.
A mighty, mighty, great God.
He's a great God.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is, yes, he is.
He's a great God.
Yes, he is, yes, he is, yes, he is.
He's a great God.
Yes, he is, yes, he is, yes, he is.
He's a great God.
Now open up a shout with the fruit of your lips. Come on, with the fruit of your lips. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, open your mouth. Open your mouth. Hallelujah. He's a great God. Hallelujah. 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 He is a great God. Awesome and mighty. He's a mighty good God. He's victorious and glorious. He's an awesome God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I wish we could connect the praise on this Palm Sunday. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, shake yourself. He's a great God. He's a great God. He's a great God. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he's done for me, he's a great God. My soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. When I look back over last week, he's been good. Hallelujah. When I think about Monday, he was good. When I think about Tuesday, he was just as good. When I think about Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, he was right there with me. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. For being a good God. For being a good God. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. I'm not gonna try to force you, but Lord, I thank you. Because he's a great God. And we owe him this praise. We owe him this praise. Woke me up this morning.
started me on my way, put food on my table, brought joy to my day. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. I don't need a big blessing to say thank you. Thank you for eyes to see. Thank you for ears to hear. Thank you for a voice to talk. Thank you for legs to walk. I don't need a big blessing. I don't need a check in the mail. But Lord, I thank you for the last breath I took. It was your breath. Thank you. Glory. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Lord, I thank you. Hallelujah. 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 Something about praise. There's something about praise. All right, we're gonna move on. If you gave him your best, we'll move on. If that's all he deserves after keeping you all week, we'll move on. If that all he deserves after making sure all your bills were paid and your lights were on and your family's still here, if that's all he deserves, we'll move on. But I think we could do a little bit better. I'm not gonna mess with y'all this morning. Wonderful Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mighty God, mighty God. We serve an awesome God. We serve the true and the living God. Nobody like him. Nobody like him. Nobody like my God. Hallelujah. Y'all playing with this thing. Y'all playing with it. I see you, Brother Sean. Y'all playing with it. Glory to God. All he wants is a praise. All he wants is a thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We'll move. Hallelujah. I wish I had just three dancers. I wish I had just three. I got one. I got two in the back. I'll be the third. Glory. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Glory to God. All right. Hallelujah. Maybe you'll feel like dancing after I preach. I don't know. Let's go to our Bibles. John chapter 12. John chapter 12. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are worthy. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Move by your spirit. Move by your spirit. Move by your precious spirit, Jesus. Move, Lord. Move, Lord. The book of John, chapter 12, verse number 12 to verse 15. Then we're going to hop over to the book of Luke, chapter 19. But the book of John, chapter 12, verse 12 through 15. On the next day, much people were come to the feast when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. And they took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna. Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon, as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, thy King cometh sitting on an ass's colt. The book of Luke, chapter 19, verse 36 through 40. And the Bible says, And as he went, they spread their clothes in the way, on the road. And when he was come nigh, even now, to the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. Anybody see God do mighty works in your life? So let me read that again. And when he was come nigh, even unto the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of Macedonia began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice. Y'all gonna make me work today. I could already tell, but I came ready. Y'all gonna make me work. It's all right. Rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for the mighty works that they had seen, saying, Blessed be the King that cometh in the name of the Lord. Peace be in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees from among the multitude said unto him, Master, rebuke thy disciples. Verse 40, and he answered and said unto them, I tell you that if these should hold their peace, the stones would immediately cry out. I want to talk to you this morning from the topic, the power of praise. The power of praise. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you on today for all your many blessings. We thank you for being in this place today. Lord, I pray as I preach this word, God, as I step back, you step forward. Lord, preach through me today. Let your word go out and fall on good ground. Speak today to your people. Oh, God, give them ears to hear, eyes to see, hearts to receive what you are saying in this season. Lord, we love you, we bless you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. You can grab your seats. Thank God for all of the visitors that are here on this morning. I have a couple visitor cards. I have an Aaliyah, if you just want to wave your hand so we know who you are. Right over here, Aaliyah. God bless you. Can we put our hands together for Sister Leah right over here with Sister, she's a guest of Jamie Derry. And then we have a Randall Clark. Randall, God bless you, sir. God bless you. Right over here with visitors of Jamie Derry. Amen. We could do a little better than that, Macedonia. And then we have a Latoya somewhere. God bless you right in the back. God bless you. Thank you for joining us this morning. Amen. Amen. She put that she's a first-time visitor, and she said, I'm happy to be here. Amen. We're happy to have you. We're happy to have you. We're happy to have you. There's a lot of churches in Norwalk, and Could have went anywhere, but you came here. God bless all of you. Thank you for joining us online, Facebook, YouTube, everywhere. Thank you guys for joining us on this wonderful Palm Sunday. Amen. We're going to hear what the Lord is saying. The power of praise. When you think about everyday life, we quickly realize that everything and every day is filled with praise. Think about it. If your child comes home with a good grade and they get an A on their test, you praise them. If you're a grandparent and your little grandchild says a new word they never said before, you praise them. You go crazy. They said a name they never said before. Teachers, counselors, and school workers, if their students begin to show progress, we praise them. We get excited about things that are changing even in our school system. We praise our young generation. Think about sports. Coaches praise their teams after good practices or good games. March Madness is going on with all these games, and college students are roaring and cheering and praising their team after they win and advance on. Super Bowl was last month, and we heard thunderous cheers as the Chiefs won the Super Bowl. They were praising their team. Baseball starting now, and we're going to have stadiums all across America filled with clapping and cheering and shouting with people praising their teams. Praise is something that we were born with, and it's deep inside of our spirit man. Praise is something that is an integral part of our lives. And on this morning, I want you to know these three things: that praise, we praise what we value, we praise what we support, and we praise what we love. But what about our praises unto God? Most of us would agree that God is the thing that we love and value most. So why then is it so hard so often, like this Sunday morning, to praise our God? If God is the thing that we value the most, if God is the thing that we love the most, why then is it so hard to open up our mouths and give this great God a great praise? And I want to help somebody today. I don't want to condemn you, but I want to help you, and I want to remind you that no matter how good or not so good you're feeling, He deserves all of the praise. It does not matter what's going on in my physical body. It does not matter what's going on in my mind, in my mental state. It matters that He's still worthy to be praised. It does not matter how good you can sing or can't sing. God still wants to hear your song. It does not matter if the choir's up here singing up-tempo songs or slow songs or hymnal songs. It does not matter. The Lord just wants to hear our praise coming up from the sanctuary. And on this morning, I want you to realize that it does not matter if you are by yourself. It does not matter if you are in a big group. God wants and deserves your praise. And what's important to realize and remember this morning, that no matter what I go through, keep in the forefront of your mind that God is worthy in spite of what I'm going through. He's worthy of all the praise. Even when you don't feel like praising Him, He's still worthy. Can I help somebody in here? Can I help the deep folk in here? Sometimes you simply just don't feel like praising God. I came in here to preach. Give me 20 minutes. Sometimes you really just don't feel like doing it. There's sometimes that you find yourself in a situation where praise is not the first thing on your mind. But I come to tell you, you got to do like the psalmist did and talk to himself and say, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul. And all that is within me, bless His holy name." See, the problem is we sit there and we allow ourselves to feel bad for ourselves. But the psalmist showed us in Psalms 103, he said, "Praise the Lord, oh my soul, my innermost being. I need you to wake up, soul, get it together, and I need you to bless the Lord." No matter what I'm going through, no matter what I'm experiencing, I have to praise the Lord. And sometimes you got to talk to yourself, even if you look crazy, look in the mirror and say, "Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless His name." I got to talk to my soul sometimes and say, "Soul, get in line. We got to bless the Lord." I understand you always don't feel like it, but I know you may not be where you want to be, but He still deserves the praise. I know what the doctors are saying and they're giving you bad reports, but He still deserves the praise. I know that they gave you an eviction notice, but He still deserves the praise. I know your car's getting ready to be repoed, but He still deserves the praise. No matter what you're going through, He's worthy. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. The psalmist said, "From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, He's worthy to be praised. We got to praise the Lord's name. And I want to be clear because I see some visitors. We praise the name of Jesus Christ. For there is only one God and his name is Jesus Christ. We praise the true and the living God. Not Buddha, not Muhammad, not Krishna, but we serve Jesus Christ. The songwriter said it like this. Praise is what I do when I want to be close to you. He said, I lift my hands in praise. He said, praise is who I am. It's my identity. I'm a praiser. Praise is who I am, and I will praise you while I can. I will bless him at all times. Oh, only when I feel good. No, he said, I will bless him at all times. He said, I vow to praise you through the good and through the bad. I'll praise you, Jesus, whether I'm happy or whether I'm sad, it doesn't matter. I'll praise you through it all. And people of God, you must remember that we can rejoice and we can celebrate and praise everybody else and sports teams and all this stuff as long as we keep them in their right place and don't idolize them, but never forget to remember who really deserves all of the praise. Grab your seats. I only need 20 minutes. I got 18 left. But I want you to understand that praise this morning gives you access to God. Why do we praise? I'm going to help you. Number one, praise gives you access to God. And I want you to look at Psalms 100. We all know it. Matter of fact, let's read it together. Put Psalms 100 up on the screen for me. Psalms 100, you can go to work tomorrow and tell your coworkers you preached on Sunday morning. Let's do this together. Psalms 100, let's read it together. Make a joy. Verse 2, serve the Lord. Yes. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Verse 4. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and enter his courts with praise. He's good. Give yourselves a hand. You sound mighty good. We all know that psalm. But if I can, let me just dissect verse 4 for just a minute. The Bible says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him. I feel so good up here this morning. And bless his name. If I can, in the Old Testament, Moses erected a tabernacle in the wilderness. And the tabernacle was divided into three parts. There was the outer court, there was the inner court, and there was the holies of holies where God dwelled. We remember the tabernacle. And there was only one gate, though, into the outer courts. There was only one entrance to come in. This tabernacle was built, but there was only one way you could go in. And if you wanted to approach God, everyone had to go through the same gate and enter into the holies of holies. But remember, the holies of holies was not accessible to everybody. Only the high priest could enter into the holies of holies. Regular people couldn't go in there. The high priest was the only one that could go in to the holies of holies. However, in this season that we celebrate, in this season of Resurrection Sunday, Good Friday, Palm Sunday, we're celebrating so much because our great high priest, when he went to the cross at Calvary, the Bible tells us that the veil was ripped and it allowed us access into the holies of holies. In the book of Matthew, it tells us that Jesus, when he was on the cross, he cried with a loud voice and yielded up the ghost. And all of a sudden, the Bible says the veil in the temple was torn from top to bottom. It was ripped from top to bottom, signifying that the veil had been ripped and now access did no longer have to come through a high priest. But we can enter into the holies of holies by the blood of the Lamb. I'm going somewhere. And if I could this morning, let me try to make this comparison. I believe what David might have been saying here, because David was a prophet and he was way ahead of his time. And in Psalms 100 and verse 4, when he said, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise, be thankful unto him and bless his name. I think David was saying that we no longer have to enter into that type of sanctuary and go in with a goat or with bulls or with sheep. But he's saying now the gate that we enter in through is thanksgiving. Wherever we are, it doesn't have to be the church. Wherever you are, if you want to enter into his, oh, y'all missing it this morning. If you want to enter in to his gates, you got to do it with thanksgiving. If you want to enter into his courts, if you want to come before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, I come to tell you this morning, praise is the key. I come to tell you that praise is the access code. I come to tell you that your worship is the password. If you want to come before the King of Kings, you got to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise. For the book of Hebrews said, let us therefore now come boldly before the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. If you want to approach God, if you want access to God, you better start your day with praise. You better start your prayer with praise. You better start it with thanksgiving, because that's the only way we're going to access God. I got to hurry up here. I got 15 minutes. To have direct access to God, it is essential that we come with praise. It is essential that when we walk through the doors, that we come with our hands lifted up and our mouths filled with praise. You don't need a moderator to pump and prime you. You don't need a worship leader to get you going. You don't need the pastor to tell you to think about what God did. No, we should be saying, sit down, sister. You're doing too much. We should be trying to stop you because you're so out of sorts. David was praising God to the point where he ripped his clothes off and they were saying, what in the world is wrong with him? Praise should make you look crazy. We should come running into the house of God with a praise on our lips. Shouldn't have to pump and prime people that have been saved a long time. He's done too much and he's been too good. And when I think of the goodness of Jesus, we should be praising in here nonstop and continually. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and enter into his courts with praise. Grab your seats. Grab your seats. Let me throw this in here while I'm here. Praise, number two, praise is a relationship, not a ritual. Praise is not a ritualistic thing that we do. It's not something that we do. That's not it. Take that off the screen. It's not something that we do mechanically because we have to. Praise is relationship. Praise is something that we have to have a relationship in order to do. 1 Corinthians 6 and 19 said it like this. And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. What is this saying? It's simply being put that God wants to dwell inside of us, you and I. He wants to dwell inside of us. It means that he wants a relationship with us. That's the whole reason we celebrate in this season. He came and he died on the cross that he could right the relationship that Adam messed up. Adam messed it up way back in Genesis, him and Eve, when they ate of the fruit of the tree and they were disobedient. But God wanted to restore the relationship, so he sent Jesus. God desires a relationship, but in order to praise God the right way, you must be holy. For the book of Psalms says, who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? It is he that has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. God in this season, people of God, is not looking for a mechanical praise. God in this season is not looking for people that are praising him because they were told to. He's not looking for people to praise God because they have to. He's looking for true worshipers. Because Jesus said, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must do so in spirit and in truth. And I believe the problem we often run into in the body of Christ is that our praise is no longer authentic because we've lost relationship. So we don't have relationship with God, but we want to have authentic worship. It does not work that way. You cannot have authentic praise if you don't have authentic relationship. You ever hear somebody try to compliment you and you know they don't like you? It's the most awkward thing you ever want to be around. Good job today, Pastor. I enjoyed you. I know you don't like me, sister. It's okay. But it's awkward, and that's what God is saying. I don't want you to congratulate me for being God because you have to, and it's because I'm making you. But no, I want the relationship between us, that you praise me because you really know down on the inside that you love me. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must do so in spirit and in truth. And I believe sometimes that our worship becomes a show and an experience rather than a real heart-to-heart with God. I fear that we've tried to make everybody happy, and we try to make everybody fit in, and we try to make everybody be comfortable in the church. They don't make you try to be comfortable in the bar. They don't try to make the Christian be comfortable at the workplace. They don't try to make the Christian comfortable when we're in these PTO meetings and all this foolishness and board meetings. No, they don't make the Christian comfortable there. So why do we try to make everybody comfortable and alter our worship? I'm trying to figure it out. Why do we try to alter our worship to make other people feel good? But no, I fear that we've come into a problem here, because I'm realizing that we're worshiping the recording artist more than the God that we serve. I'm fearing now we're packing out stadiums for all these people and all these singers, and nothing's wrong with it. God bless you if you do it. But we're going there packing out stadiums for live recordings, and we're going up to Bridgeport to Total Mortgage Arena, and we're going there to see our favorite group. But the problem is, when we get there, we're praising the performers and we're not praising God. I knew y'all wasn't gonna like that, but God is looking for people that are not confused in this season. We worship and praise God, not the singers. We worship and praise God, not your favorite group. When you go to see them, God bless them if they sound good. But when you get there, they're just people like you and me. They put their pants on the same way every single morning. You're there to worship the true and the living God. But the church has become so carnal and so secular. Why do I feel like staying out here for a minute? Is that now we want to be like the world so bad, we need our superstars in the church. There's no place for superstars in the church. There's no place for recording artists that get bowed down to and they sign in your chest and they sign in your tickets. The devil is a liar. There's no need for that. We're here to worship. Oh, y'all don't like this preaching. And serve the true and living God. And nowadays, it's hard to tell in the church because we look like rock concerts. It's hard to tell because we look like festivals and dance parties. But it's time that we get back to the place where we worship and praise the true and the living God. Can I take a turn here? We can not only praise God when the singer we like is in the pulpit. We can not only praise God when the preacher we like has the mic. But we got to realize that I don't care who's up in the pulpit. I don't care what they're saying. If they're talking about the death, if they're talking about the burial and the resurrection of my Lord, I'm going to say amen. We got to get out of this way of that everything is about us and praise of men. Herod in the Bible got himself in trouble. He got up and spoke so well, they started praising Herod. The Bible said he didn't give God the glory. He dropped dead. You better be careful on even receiving too much praise. We weren't built to receive that much praise. All the glory belongs to God. Hallelujah. I feel mighty good in here this morning. I got 12 minutes. People of God, we can't alter our worship to fit in with the culture. I'm just on a side street right now. I'm going to get back on track. Oh, give me a second. A.W. Tozer said it like this. Worship is no longer worship when it reflects the culture around us more than the God within us. I'll say it again. Worship is no longer worship when it reflects the culture around us more than the Christ within us. We trying to tell people we love God, but the church looks just like the club. I'm going to move off of this. I'll talk about it another day. But what God is telling us today is, in order to have true worship and praise, we must have a relationship with God. God is not looking for performers, but he's looking for true praisers. And he's looking for you in this season, with or without the mic, will you praise God? He's looking at you in this season. If we never ask you to sing a solo, will you still ride down your car and make melodies unto heaven? He's not looking for you to praise him when everybody's watching, but he's looking for true praisers. The book of Ephesians says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melodies in your heart unto the Lord. That's what we're supposed to do. So keep in mind that praise is not a ritual. It is a relationship. Number two, I don't have much time. Number two, praise paves the way for God's miracles to be displayed in our lives. Praise paves the way for God's power to be displayed and miracles to be shown in our lives. We used to sing a song in here that said, worship creates an atmosphere for miracles to occur. And there's a praise that moves the heart of God and it causes grace to flow. Praise paves the way for miracles. If you look at the book of Acts for just a minute, Acts chapter 16, the Bible tells us that there was a woman that was possessed of the devil. She had a spirit of divination. The Bible tells us she was a fortune teller, and she kept on following Paul daily and the other disciples, and she kept crying to these men and saying, "These men are servants of the Most High God, which will show us the way to salvation." She was driving Paul crazy because the woman was saying the right things in the wrong spirit. That's a message for another day, but I'm tempted to get stuck here. Let me say this. We got to be careful that we don't say the right things and do the right things ritualistically and do it with the wrong spirit. I know you can pray well. I know you can sing well. I know you can preach well. But how is your spirit? Because your prayer shouldn't irritate another believer. Your singing shouldn't irritate another believer. You got to make sure your spirit is right when you approach the King of Kings. This lady was driving them crazy because she was saying the right thing, but her spirit was wrong. She was possessed. And the Bible says she did this many days, and Paul got grieved. She's following the men of God every day, but Paul was the one that got frustrated. Paul got grieved and turned and said to the spirit, he didn't say to the woman, he looked at the spirit and said, "I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her," and he came out that same hour. Paul in this situation cast the devil out of a woman, and the people in the city got upset. This woman was making them money, and she had a gift telling fortune, so she was making her masters a lot of money. And they got angry with Paul and Silas, and they dragged them to the magistrates. They made up false accusations. Basically, they said that Paul and Silas were against the Roman government and trying to do a revolt, and they threw them in the prison. And look what the Bible says in Acts 16. It said, "And they severely flogged them and threw them in prison. And the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. And when he had received the orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in stocks." Look what happened. They're beat with rods. Many stripes, Paul and Silas, they're beat with rods. They're thrown in a prison. They're thrown in a dungeon. They were commanded, the jailer was commanded, the warden, if you will, was told, "Make sure these men are watched, because we got to make sure we watch them, secure them, put them in solitary confinement, if you will. Make sure that they can't do anything." He fastened their feet in stocks. And what this means in another version is he put them in an agonizing position. I'm going somewhere. Don't lose your focus. He put them in an agonizing position. But the Bible says in Acts chapter 16 that, "And at midnight," they were in a bad place. They were messed up. They no doubt had wounds and were sore, and they had been beaten, and they probably were bloody and battered. But Paul and Silas at midnight, they began to sing praises unto God. They begin to praise unto God. They begin to sing hymns unto God. They begin to make melodies unto God. And the Bible says when they begin to praise that the prisoners heard them. See, praise is not something that you can be embarrassed to do. I'm trying to help somebody. Somebody wants to get a breakthrough, but you embarrassed on how you gonna shout. You embarrassed on your ugly cry. You embarrassed on how you lift your hands. No, it said that when Paul and Silas begin to praise, all the other prisoners, they heard Paul and Silas singing and praising God. And I don't care what you're going through, praise is something where you can't worry about how people are looking at you. Praise is something where you can't worry about who's sitting next to me. You can't worry about what they're saying about me. You can't worry about how crazy you look. They may say I'm crazy, but they don't know what it took for me to get from last Sunday to this. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know that I thought I was going to lose my life. You don't know that I thought I was going to lose my mind. Praise is one of those things where you can't try to be cute all the time. Sometimes you got to look crazy. And the Bible said that the prisoners heard them praising God. I don't know what they were in there singing, but whatever they were singing, whatever they were praying about, it was loud enough where the prisoners heard them giving God praise. And all of a sudden, the Bible says that because they started praising, it said that the whole building began to shake. An earthquake hit the place, and the Bible said the foundations of the prison were shaken. And immediately the doors were opened, and not just Paul and Silas's bands were loosed, but everybody around them. Y'all missing it? Everybody around them. Look up and down your row. Everybody on my row. If I could break out and give God a praise, everybody on my row, their bands can be loosed. I don't care how they came in here. If we can lift up a praise, visitors come in here, backsliders come in here, unbelievers come in here. But if we can praise, y'all don't hear me. If we can praise, everybody's bands will become loose. Ah, there's power in your praise. There's power in your praise. There's power in your praise. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Grab your seats. Grab your seats. There's power in the praise. And when you praise, everything around you got to be free. If somebody on your road looking bound up and frowned up, you ought to stomp your foot. You ought to say, thank you, Jesus. And their bands will become loose. Don't judge them. Just praise God in spite of it. Don't judge them. You don't know what they've been through. Just praise God for them. Maybe they don't have the energy this morning. Praise God for them. Ah, in everybody's bands. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory. Yes. Yes. And this text teaches us, I got 9 minutes. And this text teaches us this morning that in the worst times of life, even if you find yourself in an agonizing position, you have a choice if you're going to praise God or not. Paul and Silas could have sat there and said, my legs are bound. My hands are bound. Why did they do this to us? We're bloody and we're sore. They beat us for no reason. They could have sat there and complained, but they said, instead, let's sing a song. Instead, let's praise God together because there's power in your praise. And I come to ask you this morning, are you going to let your current situation stop your praise? Are you going to let your financial status stop your praise? Are you going to let your living situation stop your praise? Are you going to let the hardships of life stop your praise? I'm not going to let any of that dictate my praise, but I'm going to praise God. And we got to be like Paul and Silas. Even though they're in a prison cell, they remembered he's still worthy. They remembered he went to a cross at Calvary. They remembered that he died but he rose again with all power. Paul remembered that when I was on my way to Damascus, a light shone from heaven and pinned me to the ground. And I heard a voice say, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? See, you got to think back on what he's done. So when you find yourself in an agonizing situation, you can praise him for what he's already done. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I gotta go. And I come to tell you, no matter where you find yourself, praise him. Hebrew boys in a fiery furnace, praise him. I saw you, Deacon Juan. He said, Emma went on to be with Jesus. I see Juan praising him. No matter what state I find myself in, God is worthy of the praise. Hallelujah. And I tell you what, no matter where you are and what you're going through, if you happen to praise God, he will show up where you are. He showed up in a jail. He showed up in a furnace, and he'll show up where you are. How do I know that this morning? I'm glad you asked me. The book of Psalms chapter 22 tells us, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. It says in the NIV version that yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. It said that you are the one that Israel praises. What this text is telling us is that praise enthrones God. Praise enthrones God. That means no matter where you are or what you're going through, oh Lord help me, it means that God pulls up a chair. When you start praising, he pulls up a chair. I don't care if you're at the barber shop and he sits right down next to you. I don't care if you're at Walmart pushing a cart. When you start praising God, he's enthroned. Y'all don't hear me. He's enthroned in your praise. I don't care if I'm at Walmart. I don't care if I'm at Target. If I can just dare to say hallelujah. If I can just dare to say thank you, Jesus. He inhabits the praise. Oh, I'm preaching better than you saying amen. He inhabits the praises of his people. If I'm in my office, he shows up. If I'm riding down the street and I can just muster up enough strength to say hallelujah, he'll sit in the passenger seat. He inhabits the praises of his people. Glory to God. I'm saying, Lord, pull up next to me in my life and sit down next to me. I gotta keep a praise in my lips. He'll show up wherever we are. And in Psalms 22, the psalmist was making it clear that he had absolute trust in God. No matter what was happening at that moment, no matter how alone he felt, he knew that God was present. Sit down. And he is in control, ruling over every single circumstance. We praise God because he's worthy, number one. We praise God because it gives us access. We praise God because it paves the way for miracles, Sister Connie, signs and wonders. When we start to pray, praise God, it paves the way. Number three, and I'm going to hurry up. I got 4 minutes. The Bible, what we see here is that praise defeats the enemy. This is the one I like. Praise defeats the enemy. The Bible tells us that there are 12 tribes. We know that. And one of the tribes goes by the name of Judah. And the Bible tells us that Judah simply means praise. So wherever we see Judah in the text, it means praise. And whatever, in Judges chapter 1 and chapter 1 verse 1, it says, now after the death of Joshua, it came to pass that the children of Israel asked the Lord, saying, who shall go up for us against the Canaanites first to fight against them? And the Lord said, praise shall go up first. He said, Judah shall go up. Behold, I delivered the land into his hand. Somebody's missing it this morning. God sent praise into battle first. When you go into battle, you gotta enter battle with praise. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 20. The Bible tells us that there's a huge army coming from across the sea. There's an army coming and they have declared war on Judah. And Jehoshaphat, the leader of this army, he was terrified. I come to tell you, men and women of God, leaders in the body of Christ, we still get a little nervous. And Jehoshaphat was terrified and he called a fast. He called the people to the temple to pray. And in this prayer, Jehoshaphat reminded God of his promises to his people. Jehoshaphat reminded God of all the promises that he made, the precious promises. And after Jehoshaphat prayed, the Bible said the prophet showed up. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and 15. It says that when he showed up, he said, be ye not afraid nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude. For the battle is not yours, but God's. He said, tomorrow go down against them. Behold, they come up from the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. And in verse 17, he said, and ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Oh, I wish you would get happy. You don't need to fight in this battle, but he said, set yourselves. Get in position. Dig your feet in the sand, people of God. Set yourselves in prayer. Set yourselves in your word. You don't have to fight, but you gotta set yourselves. And stand ye still and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not. O Macedonia, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. But look what they did before they even went out to battle. They worshiped. Praise went first. Before they did anything, they worshiped. The Bible said in verse 18, and Jehoshaphat bowed his head with his face to the ground, and all Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. And the Levites and the children of the Kohathites and the children of the Korahites stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a loud voice on high. Look at this, people of God. Before the battle even started, they believed what the prophet said and they shouted with a loud voice. They didn't have to see this thing come to pass, but they begin to worship and sing praises and shout unto God, not because they saw anything, but they believed the word of the Lord. And it's important here to realize that the people did not wait until the battle is over. That's where this script, that's where that song comes from. They did not wait until the battle is over, but they praised him now for what he was getting ready to do. My God, my God. They praised him in their current situation. Listen, in 2 Chronicles 20, nothing changed. The only thing that happened was a word of the Lord came. Their situation did not change. The army was still coming, but a word of the Lord came. Situation didn't change. Circumstance didn't change. You're still sick in your body. You still don't have money to pay your bills, but a word of the Lord came. and it said you're going to win this battle. And look what happens. They didn't wait till the battle was over. But look what happened this week in prayer. God told us on Thursday night, he said that this is the season of answered prayers. For those of you that weren't there on Thursday, God spoke and said, this is the season of answered prayers. He said that this is the time when you ask me, I'm going to hasten to perform my word. I'm talking about past prayers, old prayers, but current prayers. If you ask me, start looking for it. Don't ask me in doubt, but ask me and start looking for what I'm going to do. Psalms 138 is the scripture he gave us. He said, though I walk in the midst of trouble, thou wilt revive me. Thou shalt stretch forth thy hand against the wrath of thine enemies, and thy right hand shall save me. Verse 8, the Lord will perfect that which concerneth me. Thy mercy, O Lord, endureth forever. The Lord will complete that which concerns me. Forsake not the work of thine hands. And God told us on Thursday, he said, I will not forsake the work of my hands because I built this ministry. Oh, y'all not getting happy. I built this ministry. Elder Stevens, yes, he was in charge, Big Daddy, but they didn't build this ministry. I didn't build this ministry. God said, I with my own hands have built this ministry. I put my name on this place, and therefore I will never forsake the work of my hands. And I'm going to complete that which concerns you. So we must be like Judah on this morning. In 2 Chronicles, we must be like them, and we must realize that we gotta praise God before we see anything come to pass. Judah praised God before the battle was won, but they also praised God during the battle. They didn't just praise God before, but they praised God during. The Bible said that the praise was their strategy to win the fight. Look at 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and verse 21. And when he had consulted with the people, Jehoshaphat, and he appointed singers unto the Lord, that they should praise the Lord in the beauty of holiness, as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord sent ambushments against the children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir. And they will come against Judah, and they were smitten. The Bible tells us that God, as they prayed during the fight, God confounded the enemy. And when they heard the praises of the people, he caused the enemies to fight and destroy one another. And when Judah arrived on the scene, I wish somebody would get happy. When Judah arrived on the scene, God, just like God said, they didn't have to fight. All they had to do was collect the spoil. He said it was the year of restoration. He said it was the year of renewal. He said it was the jubilee. We don't have to fight, but all we got to do when it's all said and done is go collect the spoil from the enemy. And the Bible said not only did they fight before the battle, not only did they fight during the battle, but they praised after the battle. The Bible said as they returned to Jerusalem with joy. So I come to tell you, I don't know if you find yourself going into a battle. I don't know if you find yourself in the middle of a battle. And if I don't know if you found yourself on the victory of another side of the battle. But I come to tell you, no matter where you find yourself, praise is calmly for the upright. And you ought to praise God no matter what you're going through. You ought to praise him for his wonderful works. Praise him for his word. Praise him while you wait. Praise him when he does it. Praise him for his word. Praise him while you wait. Praise him when he does it. I wish we would get happy. Praise him for his word. Praise him while you wait. Praise him when he does it. Praise him for his word. Praise him while you wait. Praise him when he does it. I come to tell you that praise on this morning gives us access to God. Praise paves the way for the enemy to be defeated. And praise paves the way for miracles. And it's important on this Sunday morning, I'm out of time, but it's important on this Sunday morning to realize on this Palm Sunday why we are praising our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Can I get three more minutes? Thank you. As we realize on this Sunday morning why we are praising our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. John chapter 12 tells us that much people were waiting and they were going to a feast, but they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So all of a sudden, the people of God, they got their palm branches. They said, let's go get some palms. And we got to go get some palms because Jesus is coming through to Jerusalem. So they took palm branches, and the Bible said they went forth to meet him. This service is all about praise. They went forth to meet him, and they cried, Hosanna. Talk back to me. Hosanna. Blessed is the King of Israel that cometh in the name of the Lord. And the Bible said when Jesus found a young ass and he sat thereon, as it is written, daughter of Zion, this was a prophecy that your king is coming, riding on an ass's colt. He's coming riding on a donkey. And the Bible says in the book of Luke that as he went, these people weren't rich, but they took their garments and they laid them in the pathway. These people didn't have much money, but it's important to note here that whatever your financial status is, it does not dictate your praise. I don't care if you're a millionaire or I don't care if you're on welfare. If you gotta pray, if you know God, you ought to praise him no matter what you're going through. These people here, they were poor. They didn't have much money, but it did not dictate what they did for Jesus. So they took their clothes and they laid them in the street. And the Bible says that as they did this, it was a sign of their reverence. It didn't matter what situation they were in, but they rolled out the red carpet. They didn't have the red carpets we have now, but they rolled out the red carpet. They might have laid down some jackets with holes in them. They might have laid down some pants with holes in them, but they did the best they could and said, Hosanna, blessed is he. Hosanna, blessed is he. They laid their garments on the ground. They took their palm branches and waved them in the air. We don't have much to give you, but we give you this praise. And the Bible says that as Jesus was coming, they got angry with the disciples and they said, you got to shut these people up. Why do they keep praising your name? Master, tell them to stop talking. Tell them to stop saying Hosanna. Tell them to stop worshiping you. But look what Jesus says. He said that I tell you this, that if they should hold their peace, if they stop crying Hosanna, you see them rocks over there, they'll start to cry out. And I don't know about you this morning, but I won't let a rock cry out for me. But as long as I got breath in my body, I'm going to give God the praise. As long as I got the activity of my limbs, I'm going to wave my hands. I don't care if I look crazy. He deserves the praise. Let me make this point here. The people were shouting Hosanna. That means save us now. Save us now. They thought Jesus was coming to deliver them from Roman oppression. He thought he was coming to deliver them right there. They thought he was coming as a conquering king. But no, he was coming. Oh, God have mercy. He was coming as a lamb that was slain from the foundations of the earth. He was coming humbly and lowly. And he was coming in. And that's what this service this morning, people of God, is all about. He made his triumphant entry into Jerusalem to die for the sins of the world. He was coming in lowly. Come on, let me hear. Let's go. He was coming in lowly. He was coming in humble. He was coming in as the lamb. He was coming in to be sacrificed for the sins of the world. So I come to tell you this morning, excuse me if I'm loud. Excuse me if I'm excited. But he died for me. Excuse me if it's too noisy in here. But when I was a wretch undone, he died for me. And you may be saying this morning, preacher, why do you praise him? I praise him because when I praise him, he shows up. When I praise him, he works it out. When I praise him, he fixes it. When I praise him, I feel better, so much better. When I praise him, I feel good in the city of my soul. When I say hallelujah, it feels good. They used to say hallelujah anyhow. Never let your troubles get you down. When trials come your way, hold your head up high and say, hallelujah. Oh yeah, I got a church. Hallelujah. Anyhow, so no matter my circumstance, if I'm sick in my body, I will bless the Lord. No matter if my body's rocking with pain, I will bless the Lord. If I lose my job, I will bless the Lord. Why do I praise him? Because he came into the world, and the Bible tells us that he came to his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become sons of God. I praise him because I'm a child of the King. I praise him because he's my father. I praise him because he's my friend, and he sticks closer than a brother. I praise him because he's the bread of life. I praise him because he's the light of the world. I praise him because he's the door. I praise him because he's the good shepherd. I praise him because he's the resurrection and the life. I praise him because he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. I praise him because he is the true vine. I praise him because he's Alpha and Omega. I praise him because he's the beginning and the end. I praise him because he's the author and the finisher. I praise him because he's a healer. I praise him because he's a deliverer. I praise him because he's a way maker. I praise him because he's my friend. I praise him because he picked me up and he turned me around and he placed my feet on a solid ground. I praise him because he brought me out of the darkness into the marvelous light. I praise him on this morning because the old folk used to say that he's the bright and the morning star. I praise him on today because the old folk used to say that he's a lily in the valley. I praise him because the old folk used to say that he's a rock in a weary land. I praise him on this morning because he's my rooftop in the rage of a storm. I praise him on this morning because he's a keeper if you want to be kept. I praise him because they used to say that he's a mind regulator. He's a lawyer in the courtroom. He's a doctor on the sick bed. I come to tell you that he's a bridge over troubled water. He's a burden bearer. He's a heavy load sharer. I praise him this morning because I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within. But I was sinking to rise no more. But the master, I know the master, but the master of the sea heard my cry. He heard me say help, and love lifted me when nothing else could help. Why do I praise him? Because when nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Why do I praise him? Because Isaiah tells us that he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes I am healed. Why do I praise him? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. I don't care if you black or white. I don't care if you're Indian or African. I don't care if you're Asian or from Ethiopia. Wherever you're from, whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Why do I praise him? Because he went to a cross on a hill far away. Why do I praise him? Because they hung him high and they stretched him wide. Why do I praise him? For me and you, he died. I praise him because that's not how this great story ends. But in 3 days, somebody say 3 days later, 3 days later, he got up with all power. That's why I praise him. That's why I give him glory. That's why I lift up his name, because he's worthy. He's worthy. Somebody ought to praise God. I gave you enough reasons to run around this place. Praise ye the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord. We serve a mighty good God. Glory to your name. Everyone standing, if you're not standing. We've got a reason to praise God. and there's power in your praise. There's power in your praise. The book of Psalms chapter 150 says it like this: praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. Praise him with the timbrel. I heard the tambourine this morning. And with a dance. Praise him with the string instruments and the organs. Praise him upon the loud sounding cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything. Yes, sir. Let everything. Let everything. Let every creeping, crawling thing. Let everything. Glory to God that has breath. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. We serve an awesome God. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. People of God, there's power in your praise. Don't let any circumstance stop you from praising God. Don't ever make it where the preacher got to work you up to praise your God. He's been too good. It's personal. When you come into church, you ought to say, this one's personal. Yeah, this got nothing to do with you. This got nothing to do with my wife. This is personal. I got to praise the God who died for me. Hallelujah. Bless the wonderful name of Jesus. And as we leave this place praising today, let's sing Hosanna, Blessed Be the Rock. Let's sing that on this morning. But if there's one that doesn't know Jesus, if you don't know him on this morning, we invite you to come to the altar. I pray with you. Jesus Christ died for you. He went to a cross lonely by himself, took on flesh, and he died on a cross for you. So you don't have to go to hell. So you don't have to forever be separated from him. But if you don't know him today and you leave this place and God forbid you die, there is a hell that you're going to if you don't accept Jesus Christ. There is no two ways about it. We try to do this in a way where we try to tell people, well, you can kind of, you know, we don't know and there's a gray area. No, it's either you accept him or you don't. The Bible said, Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and nobody comes to the Father but by me. Can't get there through Buddha. Can't get through crystals, can't get through any other thing but the name of Jesus Christ. And you got to accept him and you got to receive him into your life. If you don't know him this morning, we'll take you. We'll take you. If not, get ready to sing that, please, so we can transition right into that. You can start playing it. If you don't know Jesus, come to the altar. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen, saints. Let's sing this together. Come on.
For he is worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord. For he is worthy to be praised. Hosanna.
Come on, let's sing.
Blessed be the rock.
Blessed be the rock.
Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna.
With me. You can stay there. You can stay there. Let's bow our heads. We're going to leave here praising. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We're going to come back on Good Friday. We're going to take the Lord's Supper in here, the Holy Communion, and we're going to consecrate all week long. Amen? Yeah. We're here all week in prayer every single day. I don't know if we still have that picture from last week, but every day, Monday 7, Tuesday 6, Tuesday at 6 p.m., Tuesday at 6, the choir has rehearsal. There it is right there. Wednesday, we have no Bible study online. Online visitors and people that normally join our Bible study, We will not be on Google Meets this week. We'll be in the house of God. If you can make it, come by. Prayer 7 p.m. Thursday 7 p.m. Good Friday, we're in the house of God again for a Good Friday service to celebrate what he did on that cross. Amen? And then Saturday, we're in here prayer again. And then Sunday, we're going to come in here and have a time. Resurrection Sunday. Amen? And invite somebody to church. Tell them to come out to church. Tell them to come. Tell them to come. Tell them to come to the house of God. Amen. There's a dying world, and we got to invite people in. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you today for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy and your love. Lord, I pray all week long that you help us to realize the power we have in praise. Lord, I pray, God, that you touch every heart in this place. Oh, God, everyone that walked through these doors, God, give them a special blessing and a special touch from heaven. Lord, we thank you and we believe you. We thank you for saving our souls. And we thank you, God, for the privilege to be able to give you all the praise, glory, and honor. Lord, we bless you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen and amen.
Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna. Blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Rock of my salvation, Hosanna. Blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation, Hosanna. Blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation.